Welcome to Chem Help ASAP. Let's talk about this kind of interesting trait for of carbocations, and it's the fact that they can undergo something called a hydride shift. So at the top of the screen, we have a halide. This is a secondary halide, and it's going to undergo a savolysis reaction using an alcohol solvent, which is typical. And what we would expect to get if we perform this reaction is we'd expect to replace the bromide with a methoxy group, which came from our methanol, at this particular carbon, because that's where the bromide started. Well, as it turns out, in this reaction, we get an unexpected product. The observed actual product has the methoxy group one carbon over. Well, that's kind of weird, and so something must have happened. So let's try to understand what has happened, and we'll see this is pretty common, but we can understand it and anticipate it pretty easily. So here's our starting material in the bottom left. We have our bromide. The first step in one of these SN1 solvolytic reactions is that the leaving group leaves. And this is going to give us a carbocation intermediate. Now, what kind of carbocation is this? Well, we started with a secondary bromide, and so we will get a secondary carbocation. Secondary carbocations are okay, but they are not the best. It would be better if this were a tertiary carbocation. But we can't just pick and choose what carbocation we get. It comes from the halide. As it turns out, however, there is, next door, a highly substituted carbon. And what can happen in this case is our hydrogen next door can actually jump over with its electrons. So remember, in the mechanism, we're moving the electrons. And so this arrow starts at this carbon-hydrogen bond because those electrons are going to move. Along with those electrons, we're going to move the hydrogen as well. So we're moving the hydrogen and its electrons together. A hydrogen with a lone pair is called a hydride. So we call this a hydride shift. Now, the interesting thing is, what is the outcome of this kind of reaction? Well, this hydrogen, let's put a star on it, is now over here. And I don't want to slight the fact that there was already a hydrogen on this carbon to begin with. So now we have two hydrogens on there, but one of them came from a neighboring carbon. Where did our charge go? We haven't lost anything from our molecule. The positive charge must be somewhere. And it turns out it's right there. This is now a tertiary carbocation. That's better. So there's a driving force for this hydride shift. It gives us a more stable carbocation. And that's the driving force that causes hydride shifts. Now, one qualifier, you can't have hydride shifts all the way across a molecule. The hydride shift occurs from a neighboring carbon. So don't think I can move hydrogens anywhere I want a carbocation. You can't. You can only move them to the next door carbon. Regardless, we now have a tertiary carbocation. And when our nucleophile, our solvent, gets around to attacking the carbocation, it's now going to attack at this tertiary carbocation. And so that explains how we got our methoxy group on apparently the wrong carbon, the carbon we didn't expect. So this is a hydride shift. We can see them coming. It's fairly predictable. It's a very fast process. In fact, it's so fast it occurs before our weak nucleophile attacks. But this is the hydride shift. It's a common occurrence in any carbocation-driven mechanism.